good. Thank you for the inspirational praise and worship, Brother Carlos, Sister Trick. Praise God. Well, good morning, everybody. It's Sunday, right? What do we used to say? T-G-I-S. That's it. T-G-I-S. Thank God it's Sunday. What's going on? Let's see. The wings are filling out pretty good. The center aisle's getting really thin. All righty. We're going to have to work on that. Everybody over here, if you'll shift over here, you know you hate it when people tell you to do that, right? I hate it when they don't interrupt my comfortness here. You know, I think God wants to talk to us today in a really practical way. You know, it seems as if life is very busy. And even as individuals, you know, our worlds become filled with a lot of things. It's amazing that you're able to, the ones that are here and the ones that are even online listening, it's amazing that you're even able to find a moment to stop what you're doing and come to church. And I'm sure you consider yourselves to be quite accomplished when you are able to do that. But it's true, isn't it? Sometimes life is so full, we can't even make it to church on Sunday. And this is not condemnation, this is God. I think God wants to talk to us. Sometimes life is so full and busy, it's like we come to church, we're here. Sometimes we make it, but our minds don't make it, you know? It's like, you know, we're going to come to church, but, you know, the church is not the most important part of the day. You know, usually it's like, okay, I can get out by 1 o'clock. And God forbid we let you out at 1, it'd be over. We'll get you out by noon. And then, you know, you plan what you're going to do after church. Isn't it amazing, you know, in our heads that life is so busy, it's like, oh, this is just conversation, I guess. You say, life is so busy, I can't go to church, when church is really just an hour. It's an hour in the week, maybe an hour and a half. But we feel like we're so consumed, and as if church takes up so much of our time, we can't go. Really? We'll come to church, and a lot of times, you know, we're sitting here in church, and the truth of the matter is, and this is true for me, more for Pastor Phil than myself, but you can't even listen to the message. Because, I mean, how many times, you don't have to admit out loud to me, I can just tell you how I feel at times. You know, sometimes you're sitting here listening to a preacher preach, but you're really not. Amen? Like, how many times do we have, like, 10 other thoughts in your head? Right? Some of you probably aren't even hearing me right now. Some of you guys checked out the minute I got up and said good morning. Good morning. Okay, this will be about a half an hour. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Pastor Phil and myself, we do our darndest to try to, Phil fails more than I do, to retain your attention. That's why he resorts to singing and dancing. Don't get me wrong, yeah. I know why he sings and dances. I'm not going to act the fool. If I do not entertain you, then so be it. They say nowadays the average retention, I think it's diminished since, 20 minutes. You can only keep someone's attention for 20 minutes. Don't speak more than 20 minutes. Okay? I'm sure give it some time. That'll go down to 10 minutes, 5 minutes, 2 minutes. You need lots of visuals nowadays, right? You got to entertain all the senses. Have you heard these things? Yep. Because we got a lot going on. It's true, we got a lot going on. Some of you have come today happy. Some of you have come today sad. And you'll do your best to hear God speak to you, but you'll probably be preoccupied with what has made you sad. You'll probably be preoccupied with what's making you happy. You're probably just preoccupied with what's going to happen next. What are you going to do this week? Can I get an honest amen? Amen? God knows that. You know that? God's not insulted. You know, Phil and I are insulted, but God's not. God knows that. And he loves us. I think he's going to talk to us today and I don't know, maybe help us. Because we're so busy. We're so busy. It's just life. You know, usually at the end of our busyness or crisis, you know, we say if God would just speak to us. Truth of the matter is God is ready and willing. But we're too involved with our life. And that's okay. This is not condemnation. This is humanity, right? We're too involved with our life. I'm often reminded, I believe there's many times in my life, maybe your life as well, like God has something to say to me, but he knows I'm not ready to listen, you know? You ever been involved in like in a project And like, you know, somebody's trying to get your attention. If not God, somebody's trying to get your attention. It's like, okay, just give me a minute. I got to finish what I'm doing first, right? That's the way we are. And God, too, you know, we're in the midst of whatever we're doing, and God wants to speak. And we say, I just got to finish what I'm doing, and then we'll chat. I do that frequently with the Lord, as much as you all. But that's human nature. Can I get another amen? God knows that. So he works within those limited parameters, and he does mighty things within those limited parameters of ours. I know God has a word for us. I know God has a very specific word for every one of us. I believe God will speak to you where you're at. That's what you prayed, brother. I'm thinking about you right now, Deacon Barnett and Brother Ken. I don't know if Brother Ken's online or not, but God does have a word for us in the midst of what we're going through. He wants to speak specifically to you. I'm thinking of our Brother Bill. He's in the hospital right now, and Brother Bill, God has a specific word for you. Never mind what you want, Brother Bill, God has something for you, and he loves you as we do. God has a specific word for every one of us. Amen? Yeah. And sometimes we try to get right to the point because sometimes our attention span is not long, at least for the things we don't want. For the things we do want, it's very long, right? But for the things that we put up with, it's not very long, so let's get right to it. Do you remember the story in the Bible? Maybe you don't. Maybe this is new to you. There was an account in the Bible when the sun stood still. Does anybody remember about the story or the day when the sun stood still? It just came to mind because we were doing the fourth day of creation on Friday. And on the fourth day of creation, God created the lights, sun, moon, stars. History records, or at least the Bible history records, there was a day when the sun stood still. Do you remember the leader of the Israelites when the sun stood still? His name was Joshua. As far as Bible history is concerned, there was a man named Abraham. Abraham had no children. He wanted to have a child. He didn't have the promised child until he was 100 years old. Finally, he got his child, his son of promise, 100 years old. And then after that, you know, his son had a son. His son had a couple of sons. One of his sons was called Israel. Israel had 12 sons. This man who had no family, all of a sudden, he's beginning to become a very large family. So Israel had 12 sons, and then, you know, 12 sons, they became the nation of Israel today, right? They became a nation. They went into slavery, Egyptian slavery, for 400 years. The great deliverer came and delivered them from slavery. Please tell me the name of the deliverer of the Israelites. Moses. Moses delivered the Israelites. He brought them out of the promised land. They were in bondage for 400 years. He brought them in the he was bringing them to the promised land. Does anybody know how long the journey took? 40 years. 40 years. As a matter of fact, it took so long, Moses was going to die. He wasn't even going to take him into the promised land. Does anybody know how old Moses was when he died? 120 years. Is this important? Not really. Very good. Very good, old man. To him, it was important that he lived 120. That's good, Pop. That's good perspective. So, Moses had a leader that would lead the great people of God when he left, and that leader's name was Joshua. He was son of, does anybody know his parents' name? No, he was son of Nun. His father's name was Nun. His father's name was Nun. It was N-U-N, and I've heard some preachers, my brother, he thought it meant that he had no father. He said, Joshua was son of Nun. He had no father. I tried to explain to him. No, that was the name of his father. It was N-U-N. But I try to help Pastor Phil before he preaches. I only have a few minutes before service time. Okay, I'm going to go on. It's just too easy. Joshua. Now, Joshua was called to a great task. It was Joshua's job to get the Hebrew nation. They were a people of slaves. They were without education, without training. They were slaves for 400 years. And it was Joshua's job to bring them to the land of Canaan. Canaan was a land that had great nations. There were seven nations that lived in Canaan before the one nation that would take them all out. We talked about them last week. Bible says the seven nations that lived in Canaan, they were the greatest nations on earth. They were warrior nations. They had warriors that lived in these nations for hundreds of years. Some say that the Rephaim lived among them. The Rephaim were the giants that lived to be 800 and 900 years old. They had been living in warfare and trained in warfare. Could you imagine? No. For 800 years, they were trained in warfare. Og and his brother. Does anybody remember Og's brother's name? Sion. The two brothers, these were the great Canaanite warriors. They were 800 and 900 years old. They were about 9 feet tall. And when Moses came and said, I'm going to conquer you guys, I'm going to take your land, these giants said, you ain't taking nothing. I'm going to crush you like a grasshopper, like I have crushed every other attempter to the throne prior to you. And history tells us that Moses responded. He was 120 years old. He said, listen, mighty warrior, I'm taking you down. I'm going to, feed your flesh to the fowls of the air, something like that. And he did. Legend tells us that when Moses encountered these two great giants, that he ran into battle, and then he jumped and he flew into the air, and he took his spear and he slayed the 900-year-old warrior Og and brought him down to nothing. Moses passed the scepter to Joshua, and before they even entered the land, Moses said, Joshua, it's your job. You got to go take care of all these guys. That was just one giant. There was nations of giants. These nations battled, and they were experts in warfare. And the mantle was passed to Joshua. I think Joshua and the Israelites encountered one of the greatest cities to, get inaugurated, to break them in. Remember the first city that Joshua conquered? Jericho. Jericho was the walled city. The legend tells us that no one could conquer Jericho. It was like the Great Wall of China. They had this great wall around Jericho that chariots would ride upon the walls, like the Great Wall of China. You can't conquer this land. Do you remember how Jericho conquered that land? With a shout. Yeah, he walked around. You're right. He walked around, marched around that city for 7 days. And then what they do, they gave a shout, man. They shout praises to God, and they played their trumpets. And what happened to the great walls of Jericho? They fell to the ground. Ha. Ha. The next greatest nation was a city called Ai. They were going to conquer Ai, and they did conquer Ai. There's a lot of history involved with that, but they finally conquered Ai. And then the next city over, they're starting to get wind, like, wow, these Israelites are tough. The next one was Gibeon, and Gibeon was a mighty nation, and Gibeon said, let's not fight the Israelites. Let's go make friends of them. Let's create some kind of a pact. And they did. They did. And Joshua, not really knowing fully what he was doing, but he did. He made a pact with Gibeon. He said, Gibeon, we won't conquer your nation. We'll leave you alone, and we'll let you live in peace with us, and we'll go conquer the other guys. And the other great nations around Gibeon, they discovered. They said, Gibeon betrayed us. And as a matter of fact, it was Jerusalem at the time. Adonizedek, he was king of Jerusalem at the time, before it belonged to Israel. And he said to other five great nations around him, they said, let's not go fight against Joshua. You know what they said? Let's go fight against Gibeon. They betrayed us. So five nations came. They didn't care about Joshua anymore. They were going to get Gibeon. So they marched off to Gibeon. And what did Gibeon do? Gibeon said, hey, we got a new ally, the Israelites. They sent out their messengers. They go in a hurry. Go tell Joshua we're in a mess over here. Pretty smart. Joshua, man of God that he is, said, okay, we're going to come rescue you. Scripture says they marched through the night without sleep. They marched through the night to get there on time. Can you imagine the five kings when they saw Joshua and his men there? It's like, what? We were trying to avoid this. So Joshua began to do battle on Gibeon's behalf. Joshua, who was in charge of the slave nation, he was fighting against five experienced armies. And of course, Joshua was winning the battle. And as he was winning the battle, it seemed like the day was coming to an end. This is where we get to our point here. The day the sun stood still. And Joshua asked God if he would let the sun stand still so that he could finish this mighty conquest. Maybe we can read. Let's just take a look at that just for a second. We'll read a couple of verses. Genesis, Joshua chapter 10. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua. Let's just read a couple of verses this way. You cannot say that the preacher didn't use the Bible today. That's usually why I open it up. That preacher don't use the Bible. All righty. So let's see. Verse 9 says, Joshua therefore came unto them suddenly. Kind of shocked them, right? And he went up from Gilgal all night. And the Lord discomfited before Israel and slew them in a great slaughter at Gibeon and chased them along the way that goeth to Beth-horon and smote them at Azekah and unto Makkedah. And it came to pass as they fled before Israel and were going down to Beth-horon that the Lord cast, listen to this everybody, the Lord cast great stones of heaven upon them unto Azekah, and they died. That next sentence there, it says, they were more which died with hailstones than they whom of the children of Israel slew with the sword. Isn't that incredible? This great battle, more of the people died from the hailstones, not from the army of Israel. My goodness. Okay, there's more. So then spake Joshua to the Lord in that day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And Joshua said in the sight of Israel, he said, Son, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed, until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still. The sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hastened not to go down about a whole day. And there was no day like that before it or after it. What, that the sun stood still? Well, it says that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man. For the Lord fought for Israel. Let me read the next verse. And Joshua returned all Israel with him unto the camp of Gilgal. They figured they were finished fighting. But then a messenger came to Joshua and said, hey, we found the five kings. They're hiding in a cave. And Joshua said, whoa, okay, that's interesting. Why don't you go put a big stone in front of that cave, keep a couple guys there so they don't get away, and let's go destroy them utterly. He thought he was done. He said, since we got the five kings, let's destroy them completely. You know, the sun ain't going to set for a while. Let's keep going. So they did, and they destroyed them utterly. And then it says, let's see, we go down a little bit further. And it came to pass, verse 20, when Joshua and the children of Israel had made an end of slaying them with a very great slaughter, till they were consumed, that the rest which remained of them entered into the fenced cities. And all the people returned to the camp of Joshua at Makkedah in peace. None moved his tongue against any of the children of Israel. And then Joshua said, open the mouth of the cave, and bring out those five kings unto me out of the cave. And they did so, and brought forth those five kings, those five mighty kings, unto him out of the cave. And the king of Jerusalem, the king of Hebron, the king of Jarmuth, the king of Lachish, and the king of Eglon, five kings. And it came to pass when they brought out those kings unto Joshua, that Joshua called all of Israel together. He wanted everybody to see this. Come here, everybody. The battle's over. He called all of Israel. I want you to see this. He called all the men of Israel, and he said to the captains of the men of war that were with them, he said, come near, don't be afraid now, come close. And then he told the captains, you see these mighty warrior kings? What did he say? He said, put your feet on their necks. And they put their feet upon their necks. And Joshua said unto them, fear not, nor be dismayed. Be strong and of good courage, for thus shall the Lord do to all your enemies against whom you fight. Amen. That is the word of the Lord. It's interesting to me that a lot of things happened that day, maybe because it was really 2 days. History tells us that Joshua marched all night. That day, the sun was up for 12 hours. Joshua asked for another one. He got another 12 hours. He had 12 hours and 12 hours, and they marched all night. What happened in those 24 hours? More than that can be recorded. Before the sun stood still, the Bible tells us that hailstones from heaven came down. I guess they were big enough to kill a man. And I'm sure they came down out of heaven with precision accuracy. And that more of the armies were killed by these hailstones than in battle. Could you imagine that? Could you imagine that? No, we cannot imagine that ever happening. You would think that that would be, I don't know. You would think the enemies would just fall on their face at that to see heaven is against them. You would think all of the nations around them would be scared to death because they know that at this point they are not fighting man, they're fighting God. You would think everybody would be afraid. You would think even the Israelites would be a little afraid. I would, wouldn't you? It's like, wow, that one was real close to me. Because these hailstones had to be whizzing right past them, catching the guy right next to him. Like, wow. I mean, right? If you were in that battle, they'd be like, phew, phew, phew. You would think the Israelites would throw their swords to the ground and just watch God work. And that wasn't even the greatest miracle that day. Then Joshua. You know, if you were in the midst of a battle and you needed help from God, let's say you needed help from God, do you think you would actually ask God in your life? You think you would ask God to ask, you know, would you let the sun stand still? I would never ask that because that's ridiculous. I would say, God, give me strength to get through the day. I would say, Lord, give me enough money to get through the day. I would say, Lord, let the bleeding stop if you would be so kind. But I would never in my mind say, God, would you cause the sun to stand still? That thought would never come to my mind nor your mind. This is absolutely an extraordinary happening. And then if you had that thought to say that in front of everybody, I just asked God to cause the sun to stand still, so we'll be okay. And then the sun stands still. And they have 2 days and they chase the enemies. At the end of the battle, Joshua called all the men together, right? What did they talk about? What do you talk about first? Do you talk about all the hailstone? Do you talk about the mighty hailstone that came from heaven that whizzed by your face and killed the three guys next to you? Do you talk about the fact that you marched all night and you went 2 days? Do you talk about the fact, which is beyond understanding, my goodness, the sun stood still? And you and I, in our sophisticated minds, we would say, well, the sun doesn't actually stand still because the sun never moves. So this is what we think in our minds. It's actually the earth that stood still because the sun doesn't. And then we wonder, well, how does the earth stand still? Our minds are spinning. We're just spinning. And Joshua calls everybody out, and he says nothing about the hailstone. He says nothing about the sun standing still. He calls everybody together, and he says, take a look at your enemies. Take a look at your fear, what you're afraid of in life. Because the primary object here was to take the fear out of their lives. Joshua knows and God knows the greatest thing in our life is fear. Fear of man. We say we don't fear man. Well, we do. We fear what people think. We fear if we fit in. We fear if we're doing the right thing. We fear man all day long. We fear ourselves. We fear about the conditions of man. We're afraid. And God and Joshua, he knows that the greatest thing was not these things, because how come at the end of the battle, nobody's talking about the great things that God just did? Because there's a million things going on in their lives. They can't see the absolute extraordinary miracles all around them. Sometimes when you're involved with fear, all you see is your fear in front of you. Can I get an amen from somebody? You know, you could be in, let's say you're involved with this great, great public event. Let's say the president is coming to town, right? And let's say he's coming and he's going to speak at our church. And you would think the greatest excitement would be about, you know, the president's coming to town, he's going to speak at our church. But let's say Pastor Phil asked one of you if you would do the intro. Would you please introduce the president when he comes to speak? First thing that would grip your heart would be absolute terror. Fear. And then the only thing that you would be consumed about until the day was over was the fact that you had to introduce the president, and what the heck am I going to say? And now you are blind to the extraordinary event, because nobody in the world is thinking about you introducing the president. Nobody in the world even sees you. All they see is the president and the extraordinary event. But all you see is you. And you have to introduce the president. In your life, sometimes all you see is the small details of your life. You don't see the whole world around you. You see your struggles, you see your fears, you see what you're not able to do and what you want to do. All you see is you. And you think the whole world does too, but no. There's so much going on in life, and sometimes the things that are in our lives are so small, but they absolutely consume us. And I think that's kind of what's going on in the story here and in our lives. There's so much going on in life, but we're so consumed with the small details, and I think it's the small details that grip our hearts and cause us to be afraid. Because in life, there's lots of beautiful things, but there's also struggles, amen? There's also enemies. Like, you know, there's things in your life that you have to deal with, amen? And of all of the joy that you can experience and all of the beauty that you can have in life, I think what consumes us most is the one thing that we just can't get a hold of. The one thing that constantly defeats us, perhaps. And maybe you have two things. You know, I usually go before the Lord and I say, there's two things, Lord, that I want. Ha, and we end there. I don't know, what's that one thing in your life that you want to get rid of? Is it a sickness in the body? Is it a sickness? And this is real. It could be to Bill, the sickness in his body. It could be to any one of us. It's the sickness in your body. It could be the sickness in the family. It could be any other kind of a sickness. Could it be the lack of finances? Could it be whatever your worries are about tomorrow, about the job? And you're so consumed about these things. And God allows them, and the only reason why God allows them is because he's working in our lives. He's causing us the greatest thing that a human being could accomplish in life is to have our fears destroyed. The greatest thing that happened that day on the battlefield with Joshua wasn't that the sun stood still, it was hardly even mentioned. Can you believe that? The sun standing still was hardly mentioned. And when Joshua called everybody together, he didn't talk about it. What did he talk to them about? Their fears. He said, I know you're afraid. I was talking to a Navy SEAL this week. I'm telling my brother. And he served his, I don't know if he was a Navy SEAL, he was something like a Navy SEAL. He served his nation for a lot of years. And at the end of his service, there was this accident and some heavy load fell on him. I think it fell on his head. And he should have died. But they rushed him into surgery right away, and they didn't think he was going to live. And he said the surgery took 12 hours. And at the end of the surgery, the surgeons for sure said, this man will certainly not walk again. We're amazed he's alive. You know, one of those stories, right?